Hello, it's Joseph, and welcome to part two of my lightsaber building series. It's been 14 months since my first video in the series where I show the process of me building a lightsaber with the Neopixel blade, CFX sound module, and Bluetooth capability. Now, at the time of this recording, it had over 10,000 views, which is way more than I ever thought was going to happen. I made these videos to help with the education in the DIY saber community, so I'm hoping that those 10,000 views are a sign that I helped you out in some way. So in this video, I'm going to be showing you what I've been up to over the last year, in addition to building a DC-17 replica blaster, which I made a video for, and I recommend you check that out after watching this video. I made some upgrades to my lightsaber build. Now, in no way was I disappointed in what I accomplished in my first attempt at this lightsaber build for the first video. However, there were a few areas in the build that needed some improvement. Now, if you watch my first video and followed many of those steps in building your lightsaber, you may actually be familiar with some of these issues and ran into them as well. So let's go over those issues real quick, and I will explain some ways that you can fix them if you also applied this design to your lightsaber. So the first issue I ran into had to deal with the steel rods that hold the whole chassis together. So when I would go to try and tighten these nuts right here, the rods would come unscrewed from the speaker housing. And quite honestly, a lot of the issues that I'll be sharing with you can be traced back to this one issue. But this was a big problem because the rods are important for holding the whole system in place. Now, this led to the second issue, which would be that when these nuts would loosen, the chassis would come a bit flimsy. And I would test this out inside the lightsaber. I'd shake it around a bit. And what would end up happening was over time, these rods would come loose, or they'd come loose from the speaker housing. And then things would just start to rattle around. As you can see, it's already starting to rattle around now when I loosened those nuts. So this would often cause me to want to open up the saber just to get back inside and re-tighten these nuts and try and get everything to be more secure. So that then led to the next issue. And that next issue, quite frankly, was there were just way too many JST connectors. And when you have that many JST connectors, it actually creates extra points of failure in your wiring system. So when I would open it up to fix the rod issue, that would end up leading to me accidentally knocking a JST connector and doing something like, you know, messing with the solder connection inside the JST connector. And then I would have to go back and re-solder that joint. And then, of course, my Bluetooth module was in this location, and I actually purchased the second arms of yellow chassis to resolve that issue. So what I would do is I would tape down the Bluetooth module here, and I would have the JST connectors inside here, and that actually made things a little more secure inside by having this extra chassis from arms of Elam to help out with that. So there's actually a simple fix to this issue, and that is just to come in here onto the rods right here in the speaker housing and just apply some super glue, like some E6000, and put that onto the steel rods before putting it into the speaker housing, and then that makes it a lot easier for things to stay secure whenever you tighten down these nuts. And then, of course, the next fix for that is just get rid of all those JST connectors. I mean, it was nice to have those to help with modularity so that when I did have issues, it was super easy to take things apart and get to the problems as I was going through. But also, having those extra JST connectors actually ended up creating their own problems because of the extra points of failure, as I mentioned before. Now, if you watch my first video and you follow that process in building your own lightsaber, these issues don't have to be deal-breaking for you. This chassis can still work out pretty well. And in fact, I was planning on keeping this chassis, and I did that same fix myself. However, I ran into a video by a YouTuber known as Solo Sabers, and he did a tutorial showing how to design and create your own 3D printed chassis for a lightsaber, and that inspired me to go that route. So if you are possibly interested in doing 3D printing of your own lightsaber chassis yourself, I recommend you check out his video tutorials, and I'll have those linked in the description for you, and you can watch them yourself. The program that I use to design the 3D printed chassis is called Fusion 360 by Autodesk. I was able to get a free version for non-commercial use, which has more than enough features to get the job done. Here is some sped up footage of me creating my chassis in Fusion 360. I began by creating the battery holder section with a slot to hold the Bluetooth module. From there, I moved forward to the gear piece section that holds the switches before moving forward to the PCB holder. As I built this chassis, it was important to keep in mind where my wire paths would go, so you'll notice additional holes and space in certain parts of the chassis. For example, as I built this crystal chamber section you see here, there are hidden wire paths behind the crystal chamber and in these tubes. The ribbing on the tubes was just for aesthetics and served no other purpose. I wanted these tubes to look like conduits for the inner mechanisms of the lightsaber. Now, part of the reason I wanted to move the battery forward in this design was to put more of the weight forward where my right hand holds the hilt, and it seemed to keep things a little better balanced. After designing the crystal chamber, I then gave the recharge port a place to be installed. This is where most of the space for wiring is needed, so it is mostly hollow for that reason. The next section is for holding the CFX and OLED screen, which I decided to add to this saber after I purchased it for my blaster project, but this OLED turned out to not be compatible with the Blaster Core 5. The final section is for holding my 28mm bass speaker. It only needed a small wire path for two 28 gauge wires. The rest of what you see me doing in this design process is mostly adding some aesthetic qualities and making some modifications after doing some test printing and fitting. I learned from watching the tutorials by Solo Sabers that you can add text in Arabic to your 3D models, which I thought was really cool. So the text I added between the Bluetooth and crystal chamber section says Raffy Taffy Projections. The text on the sides of the CFX section say there is no death, there is the force, which comes from the Jedi code. Another inspiration from Solo Sabers was the aesthetic around the speaker holder and these indentions near the Bluetooth module and CFX. These indentions are for me to add electrical tape to help hold these boards in place. Now, you can use E6000 super glue on the sides of the modules to secure them, but I decided to use electrical tape instead. By the way, I included my notes for this chassis design in the Google Drive folder linked in the description. Keep in mind though, not all these measurements are accurate on these notes because I made numerous adjustments after testing the prints and I neglected to write all of them down. For example, you'll notice I am adjusting the length of the gear section at this time in the video, and you'll see me adjusting the holes for the PCB pins. The PCB holder had to eventually be printed as a separate piece because I could not get around it to install the switches. I also found that my design did not allow for me to easily install the recharge port into the chassis, so I created a removable piece that can be held in place by an 832 set screw, but if I need to get to the SD card, I can just remove it by loosening the screw. One of the neat things I learned about Fusion 360 is that you can create holes for screws in your model by telling the program exactly what type of screw you want to use. This was helpful for getting the exact size of hole I specifically needed to hold this attachable piece in place. One of the final parts I designed for this chassis was a resonance cap that fits around the speaker holder. I had carefully measured for this chassis to place the speaker exactly where I needed it, but this resonance cap increased the volume of the speaker even more. My 3D printed chassis was purchased from Amazon, but unfortunately the first one I purchased was defective. Here are some of the results I got from it, and these failed prints were made after several hours of trying to adjust the heating bed, the nozzle, and also just doing tons of research to try and figure out what the problem was and figuring out why these prints kept failing. I'm not going to give you the name of the defective printer because I don't want to bash a product, but after I got my second printer, it was clear the first one I got was a knockoff of Creality's printers. After sending back the defective printer, I purchased Creality's Ender 3 Max, which compared to Creality's regular Ender 3, I have a larger printing area of 300 millimeters by 300 millimeters by 340 millimeters. I needed this larger printing area because I have a long chassis and I wanted to print it off in one complete piece instead of printing it off in multiple small ones that I super glued together. This printer was an immediate improvement over my first purchase, but I went on ahead and purchased some upgrades to make it even better. After watching a video by Waltz Reviews, I purchased a second lead screw for the Z-axis with a motor and a BL Touch leveling sensor. The Ender 3 printers only come with a single lead screw, so that means that as the nozzle moves along the Z-axis during printing, it might not move evenly. With a second lead screw, the motors move up the Z-axis evenly on both sides. I got the BL Touch sensor so that the Ender 3 Max can do automatic bed leveling, and I noticed a huge improvement in the print qualities after these two upgrades. Before printing the new chassis, I took some time to test my new OLED screen that I purchased from the custom Saber shop. I have a wiring diagram in a Google Drive folder, which is linked in the description below, if you would like to add this to your Saber. To ensure your OLED is working properly, make sure to update to the latest firmware for the CFX. You can find that on Plector Labs' website. Then it was time to print the chassis. Fusion 360 allows you to export your model as an STL file, but you need a slicer application to turn that file into a GCO file for the printer. For this process, I downloaded Cura Ultimaker. If you slow down the video, you can see the settings I use for the printing. In addition to these settings, I added a command at the beginning of the G code that tells the printer to use the BL Touch to do 9-point leveling before starting the print. As you can see in the video, I printed the chassis horizontally and I thought it came out pretty well. There are a few areas that look a little rough because of the support material I needed to remove. I actually sent a message to Solo Sabers asking him how he prints his chassis for his builds on his YouTube channel, and he told me that printing vertical is best. Unfortunately, I asked that question after installing everything into this chassis, so I didn't feel like going back and redoing the whole process. After a successful print, then came the bittersweet process of disassembling the whole chassis. It was a pretty simple process to remove everything since I made the whole setup modular. The new chassis is more compact and secure, so I removed all the JST connectors except for the connector that goes straight to the battery. I wanted this to remain in place so that when the battery inevitably goes bad in a few years, I can easily replace it with a new one. Because I printed the chassis horizontally, I needed to print support material, which added some unwanted deformations. I tried to use sandpaper to smooth those out, but I may go back later and do some painting to hide those better. I just need to do some practice painting. I then needed to drill a hole in the chassis for the auxiliary switch. This was the plan from the beginning because for me it would have been extremely difficult to design the hole for this auxiliary switch into the correct position. Keep in mind my hole in the aluminum gear piece had already been drilled for the first video. Before I could finally install everything, I needed to add some length to my wires coming from the CFX since I had removed the JST connectors. This was just a simple process of soldering additional wire and allowed me to avoid removing and re-soldering wire to the board. After a little bit of trial and error, I finally came up with a sequence for installing the electronics into my new chassis. First, the quartz crystal and its 5mm RGB LED were hot glued into place. Then the recharge port needed to be screwed into place and solder all the necessary wires to it. The OLED screen was then soldered to the board and put into its slot. After that, all the wires that needed to pass through the crystal chamber, the battery holder, and the switch section, they all needed to be guided through their wire paths. After that, the Bluetooth module, PCB, and switches have their wires soldered into place. Then the speaker is installed. And the last part to be installed is the battery. For the CFX module cover, I had to run the 832 tap into the chassis to ensure the set screw would thread properly. I also made these low profile kill keys so that I can close up the hilt with a power cut to the Saber. To add some additional stability to my Saber setup, I also applied some set screws. I used half inch 832 set screws that I picked up from the local hardware store and installed them in the rib extension pieces near the threaded portions. The nice thing about this is that it allowed the set screws to be hidden when I screw the whole hilt together. Before tapping the holes, I drilled an 1/8 inch hole in the top and bottom side. It isn't necessary to have two set screws in the same location 180 degrees from each other, but I like the added stability. Well, I was already pretty happy with my lightsaber build in the first place, but I do have to say, designing my own 3D printed chassis has definitely stepped up the quality of my lightsaber. In the future, I may do some painting on the chassis to improve the aesthetic quality, but I need to do some practice painting. I do plan to continue this video series with some additional upgrades, but I don't expect these videos to come out really fast. This is a very time-consuming hobby for me, and I am a full-time teacher after all. So still, I hope you enjoyed this video and learned something from it, and that helps you in your lightsaber building project. And maybe this might also inspire you to try and get into 3D printing and designing your own 3D printed chassis as well. I want to thank Solo Sabers for your tutorial videos, which inspired me to make my own 3D printed chassis. Before watching your videos, I never realized that creating your own custom 3D printed chassis was something that I could actually do myself. So thank you so much for posting those. I also want to give a shout out to some great Saber community Facebook groups that have helped me out. The official CFX group, MHS Saber Builders Showcase, and crystalfocus.net. You guys are awesome. Also, thanks to Irv Plechter for your wonderful Crystal Focus 10 sound module. And thank you to the Custom Saber Shop for all the Saber supplies that you make available for me to do these lightsaber builds. By the way, I also made a custom 3D printed chassis for my Shoto lightsaber, and we'll be posting another video soon showing that installation. So keep an eye out for that. Well, may the force be with you, everyone, and I will see you next time I finish a project.